Good evening. I hope you enjoyed the dinner, dessert, coffee. We're going to get started. It's my pleasure to introduce Professor L. Randall Wray from the University of Missouri, Kansas City, the Levy Economics Institute at Bard College. Randy is not the person that I need to make long introductions about his work. He's one of the leading scholars in monetary theory, monetary policy, modern money theory, and the job guarantee or the employer of last resort program. One of the leading scholars on Minsky and financial instability. When Matt and I were putting together the program, it was just impossible to think of an event like this one without having Randy with us to speak on the topic. And when I contacted him, I really have to thank him again and again for, you know, pushing everything around his schedule, his busy schedule, to be with us for this conference. So thank you for being here. I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about him. I'd rather have more time listening to Professor Wray and having a little bit of Q&A at the end. So without any further ado, Randall Wray. So anyway, the problem that we have is that the financial system has been transformed in a way that is really not financing capital government. It is really involved in gambling, and it puts our economy in risk of serial bubble and bust. And even very mainstream economists now are saying things like this. Larry Summers said, basically the only thing States has going for it is bubbles, cereal bubbles, or some of us have a friend, Michael Hudson, calls it bubblonia. And, you know, this has become so obvious now that you don't have to be outside the mainstream to notice that it's going on. So the financial system is not serving us well. It actually is impeding growth of employment with rising living standards. So what we tried to do in this project was to synthesize the insights of Keynes, Schumpeter, and Minsky to formulate a strategy to promote capital development economy, very broadly construed in the way that Minsky used this term. So capital development, to most economists, means promoting private investment. And that is an aspect of capital. But also we need to promote investment in our labor force. Neoclassical economists like to call that human capital investment, as if people are sort of like machines. We don't like that terminology. And finally, public infrastructure investment, which someone mentioned earlier today. we are literally trillions of dollars short because of that chronic underfunding of infrastructure investment in the U.S. since the 1960s. So to really quickly summarize what were the insights of these three great economists. First, Keynes. Many of you here have read The General Theory, but some have not. You've heard the name Keynes, and you've heard of this thing called Keynesian economics. What was his central insight? It was his theory of effective demand. And to put it as simply as you possibly can, you can summarize his whole book in one sentence. Firms hire the resources they think they will need to produce what they think they can sell. Okay? And to a non-economist, this sounds, well, obvious. To economists, this was completely obscured by economic theory. So the important fact that Keynes is trying to make is that employment is not determinative. So it doesn't matter whether you have unemployed people who are driving the wages down. That won't induce anyone to hire them, unless they need them to produce output they think they can sell. If they can't sell the output, they're not going to hire more workers, no matter how cheap they are. And the a related idea was Keynes's rejection of the global funds theory. Okay, what does that mean? It's the basic idea that we need savings in order to finance investment. And that the big problem is that we don't have enough saving, therefore we don't get enough investment, and that is what causes unemployment. Keynes rejects this idea. And I'll come back to this because it is important for understanding what finance is all about. Finally, Keynes's theory led to what Minsky called, and most followers of Keynes call, the investment theory of the cycle. And that is the idea that it is fluctuations of investment that cause the business cycle. And now we're going to have to modify that for the modern economy. From Schumpeter. Schumpeter was Minsky's dissertation advisor, so he's very important in understanding what Minsky was all about. But he was a very important economist in his own right. And from him, we borrow two insights. The first is the link between innovation and the dynamics of the capitalist economy. So for Schumpeter, innovation is very important for stimulating the capitalist development. And the second insight was that innovation itself needs finance. The innovation has to be financed before it can generate revenues. And the reason is because if you haven't already put the innovation in place to produce, you don't have the revenues flowing in. So you need to turn to the bankers. So you call the bankers the efforts of capitalism. In other words, they are the roadblock. If they won't lend to finance investment, then capitalism cannot progress. Now, this is most obvious in the case of startups, because startup firms don't have funding. We have to modify it if, as is the case after World War II, innovations largely take place in large firms, large corporations, which already do have revenues flowing in. Okay? And so they are able to use a lot of internal finance in order to finance innovation and investment more generally. However, we need to still talk about finance, and I will, because there's a logical problem in arguing that the revenue from firms allows them to save, which then allows them to invest. And this is what Keynes was getting to in his rejection of the funds. The finance from the very beginning has to come from somewhere. So from the very beginning, all the finance that exists did come from financial institutions. It did not come from saving. It is the spending that allows the accumulation of income. some of which becomes saving. So finance really does logic keeping first. And the second reason why finance is important is really the expertise of Martin Muscat. She wrote a fantastic book, The Entrepreneurial State, which got tremendous publicity, in which she argued that in the modern developed capitalist economies, a lot of the funding of innovation needs to and does come from the state. And we have been chronically underfunding certain stages of the innovation process in which the state must play a role. And that is typically the earlier stages where it's not obvious where the profits will come from. So she points to her favorite target is Apple, where virtually everything we associate with Apple was funded and done under government funded research, not by Apple. Okay? So a lot of the money needs to come externally, and much of that from the state itself. I'm not going to talk more about that. That's really her area of expertise. Okay, moving on to Minsky. Minsky argued that the forces of the capitalist economy are not stabilizing. Okay. Now, again, if you're not an economist, this might not sound too strange, but to economists, we're taught that market forces are stabilizing. They're trying to push the economy toward an equilibrium. Okay. There are supposed to be very strong forces in the economy, always moving it toward equilibrium. Not only in every individual market, the market for widgets, price defined price that equates the supply of widgets and the demand for widgets, but more generally for the whole economy, so that every market is searching for the point of general equilibrium. Okay. Minsky said that is wrong. That is the wrong way to look at the capitalist economy. Actually, the forces themselves are destabilizing. They're pushing the economy away from equilibrium. Okay? However, we do have some institutional ceilings and floors that constrain the instability. So that we can go through periods in which the instability is not so obvious. And then suddenly, Minsky brought Schumpeter's, and by the way, this view of the capitalist economy being naturally unstable was also Keynes's view. It was not Schumpeter's. So he was moving away from his dissertation advisor here. However, he did take from Schumpeter the idea that you need finance for innovation. Minsky said you need it for investment more broadly. Even if it's not for innovation, that at least a portion of investment is externally financed, and that makes a big difference to the outcome. Now, we go even further than that, and we can say that all production from inception needs finance. Okay? And this actually was the idea, the original idea behind the draft versions of the general theory, which sort of got left out. And it's also the idea behind Marx. I won't go into it in detail, but it's the idea that in a capitalist economy, production begins with money. That is, you have to purchase and hire the resources you need for the production process, with a view to ending up with more money at the end. So you start with money to make more money. That's what capitalism is all about. So we need finance. And again, we turn to the bankers as the ethos. Because they decide whether or not they finance the production process itself. The second extension that he made to Schumpeter was the recognition that finance itself is subject to innovation. So Schumpeter is focusing on the innovations in what we call the real sector, the sector that actually is producing goods and services. Minsky said the financial system itself is always innovating. They're innovating in pursuit of profits and to get around rules and regulations that are put on them. This innovation causes the financial system, the structure of that system, to move from relative stability to instability. So Minsky's his most famous phrase is stability is destabilizing. It sounds ironic, very strange. To the extent that we're able to stabilize the capitalist economy, we're just setting up the conditions that will recreate instability. And this stability is destabilizing is mainly due to the innovations in the financial sector. The financial sector will innovate in such a way that the system becomes more fragile and subject to another crisis. Very briefly, Minsky started publishing in the 1950s. And his earliest papers were all focused on these topics. Innovation is endogenous, response to proper opportunities. He used the example of the creation of the Fed funds market. This is the bank, this is the market in which banks lend reserves to one another, and talked about how this allowed banks to get around the constraints that the Federal Reserve was trying to put on them, and also made the system a bit more fragile. Okay? I won't go into other things, but the idea is that these innovations that already were occurring in the 1950s were stretching liquidity, increasing fragility, reducing margins of safety, so that it wouldn't take a really big event to have a snowball effect through the financial system, because the amount of liquidity in that system was being reduced. However, it's that unlike 1929, stock market crash, which then snowballed through the economy and gave us the depression, we now have a government that is big enough and willing to intervene in case anything bad happens. These interventions validate innovations that were risky and encourages the financial institutions to continue to innovate. So in a sense, the government is offering a safety net. If anything goes bad, don't worry, we're there. And they call this the big government, which is the Treasury, and the big bank, which is the Fed. Both of those convene when we have crises. So these interventions can be seen as also institutional constraints on the natural instability of the capitalist economy. I'll skip the thing about multiplier accelerator. So many times in the way. It's not the idea is that we have institutions that constrain instability. And Minsky argued that the institutions we put in place mostly during the New Deal, but also after World War II, provided a semblance of stability to the system. The system appeared to be very stable. The problem is that stability will encourage innovations that make it unstable. So in the 1950s, we have what appears to be a very stable form of capitalism. But Minsky is arguing that it will not last. Crises are going to come. In the 1960s and 1970s, he continued to develop these ideas. His 1975 book is called Dominating Keynes. I won't go through any of the theory here in detail. But he developed what was called the financial instability hypothesis. And this is his most famous contribution, in which he argued that the apparent stability of the post-war period changes expectations and behavior. We went from the 1930s until 1966 without another financial crisis. It was the longest period in U.S. history. It also was the period in which the U.S. economy grew faster than it ever had. Yeah. So So we had this period that was very stable. And Mitzi is developing these theories during this period. Okay? So that is prescient. Okay? Nobody else talking about this stuff. The problem is that we can't achieve stability. Because to the extent we do, it changes the year. So what we have to do is, quoting him, devise institutional structures and measures that attenuate the thrust to inflation and unemployment. Note that this thrust is internal to the capital system. Most economic theory tells us these things are caused by shocks to the system. Okay? Being zapped from outer space or something like that. Minsky says these are internal. And slower improvements in standard living, not increasing the likelihood of depression. So this relative stability of the post-war period led to the development of a much more unstable version of what he called the 57 varieties of capitalism, which was about pickle jar. So it was sort of a joke, okay? But he did identify a number of different kinds of capitalism, some of those much more stable. Now, meanwhile, what's going on outside Minsky and a few heterodox economists in economic theorizing? Minsky died in 1996, just about the time that we had first Chairman Greenspan and then Chairman Bernanke developing what Bernanke labeled the era of the Great Moderation. So here is the conventional view. It's exactly the opposite of this. The world is now more stable. Okay, why? Well, because central bankers are doing such a great job. They know what they're doing, and not just in the United States. The claim was that around the world, central banks were doing such a great job. They've been fighting inflation, okay, and they've dampened the business cycle swings. Now, Mitzi would say, if that's true, what's it going to do? Stability is destabilizing. Right? To the extent that they had succeeded, it only encourages more risk-taking. Anyway, then they also pointed to things like globalization. Globalization makes the world safer because we're better able to absorb shocks in one particular part of the world because we have diversified our portfolio. We own assets from all over the world, so it won't matter if one country gets shocked. Improvements in information technology increases our knowledge and also increases the speed of things. Rising profits and declining corporate leverage. So this is what's making the firms safer. Securitization allowed financial institutions to better manage their risks and to allocate them to those best able to absorb them. And finally, created derivatives so that if you got stuck with some risk, you could insure against it by using derivatives. And it, I hope everyone's seen Ken Rogoff trying to explain what a credit default swap is. Hilarious. You know, Minsky had written a piece in 1987 warning about securitization. And everything's going to get securitized. So anyway, what Minsky called this sort of argument a radical suspension of disbelief. And what he meant was that you always should disbelieve the claims of this. Right? And so you always should believe that the apparent stability probably shouldn't be believed. Okay, so in the last part of his life, mostly after he moved to the Levy Institute in 1990, Minsky came back to the stages approach, which really came from his dissertation, where he argued that the United States capitalism, and Minsky almost only wrote about the U.S. So sorry, it is U.S.-centric. That in the 19th century, we had commercial capitalism. And you can think of these stages as sort of being dominated by a particular kind of financial. institution. This stage is commercial banks. Relatively simple, relatively safe kind of banking. Okay? But it wasn't able to provide for very expensive long-term investments such as railroads. It couldn't provide enough finance for them. So we had the rise of investment banks, at least for the next stage of capitalism, but finance capitalism. Turns out this kind of capitalism is extremely unstable, extremely dangerous. It collapsed in 1929. So the myths of the Great Depression, the end of finance capitalism, it failed. We got rid of it. Okay? I mean, purposely, with policy, we ended that state of capitalism. And we got the New Deal instead. And a very tightly regulated financial system that separated investment banking and commercial banking. Investment banking hardly mattered after the Great Depression. Commercial banking was very safe because it was very heavily regulated. So he called this stage paternalistic or managerial welfare state capitalism, in which the government plays a big role and in which financial institutions are very closely regulated. And then we have a lot of safety nets for consumption for the elderly. But he warned that this kind of capitalism, because it was somewhat stable, was going to change behavior. So we have financial institutions trying to get around the regulations. And by 1999, there effectively was no regulation in the system. We gradually eroded Glass-Steagall that had separated investment banking from commercial banking. By 1999, that's what we have the rise of pension funds and other kinds of managed money, which is where he took the term money manager capitalism. Huge pools of money that was professionally managed, where every professional money manager has to beat the average. Everyone knows that's not possible. How can you beat the average? You take on more risk. So they were pushed by competitive pressures to increase risk. So over time we had stability breeding instability, which means get predicted in the business. We had the accumulation of financial assets and liabilities, huge pools. I'll show you some figures in just a second. Globalization and securitization. Minsky argued that these two things are linked. You really couldn't globalize without securitizing. Why? Because if you are sitting in Germany and you want a piece of the US real estate action that's occurring in the early 2000s, you're not going to go make a home mortgage loan to some home buyer in Ohio. What you want to buy is a package of securitized mortgages. Okay. So globalization and securitization had to go together. And then finally, it wasn't just that we deregulated and stopped supervising. He said, you guys are so big and so complicated, we can't understand what you're doing, so you better supervise yourselves. In one sense, this is what the Basel Accords were all about. So supervise yourselves, please. Okay, so before 66, we had no financial crisis. We started having some small ones. In 66, was a muni bond crisis. It was easily resolved by the Fed. Over time, these crises become more frequent and more severe and harder to resolve. I've only listed the ones from the 80s. Okay, a lot of you will remember the thrift crisis. Half of all the thrifts in the country failed. This is a major crisis. It ended up costing about $200 billion and 1,000 thrift CEOs went to prison. At the same time, we had the developing country debt problem. In the 1980s, we also had LBOs. Michael Milken went to prison. In the 1990s, we had the new economy, NASDAQ, crises come more frequently and more severe. Note an interesting thing. None of these really are about investment. Okay. And so Minsky's financial instability hypothesis that he was developing in the 60s and 70s has to be modified. Because this is not the kind of cycle that Keynes was talking about and that Minsky was talking about in his early writings. Anyway, we don't need to go through this in detail. But the idea is stability encourages innovation. It looks like there's a lot of profits to be had. And we have competition by the rise of what we used to call non-bank banks. And then Paul McCulley came up with a brilliant idea called shadow banks. Competed with commercial banks. The only way to compete is to increase leverage ratios. That increases credit availability, which pushes up asset prices. That's why we continue to have asset price bubbles. Because financial institutions are competing with loans to bubbles that push up the price in a nice self-reinforcing circle. Here's a picture of the United States total financial liabilities relative to GDP. So we're not economists. We just scale it to GDP. We don't want to just put billions and trillions of dollars because obviously that's going to grow. You want to scale it relative to GDP. If you can't read the dates, the first big mountain there is 1920s and 30s. So there was a huge rise of debt. Our first, you say, debt bubble in the United States. And it crashed. And then you see how far down private sector debt falls relative to GDP. And of course, government debt rose a lot in the blue. That was World War II. And then over time, you see that the private sector debt starts to climb. Notice that government sector debt relative to GDP does not climb. It falls initially, and then it's pretty stable thereafter. And just keep that in mind whenever you hear people going on and on about government debt. Okay. Our problem has not been, and is not now, government debt. Even if you don't buy the modern grant theory, which you hear tomorrow. The government debt ratio was not our problem. Our problem was the private sector debt ratio. So, the Great Depression, we only got up to 3 times GDP, and then we collapsed. This time, we got up to 5 times GDP, and then we collapsed. And sorry, the graph doesn't go on. It does come down a bit, but it's climbing now. Okay, so we did not do what we did after the Great Depression. We didn't get rid of the private sector debt. It's still mostly there. Okay. Some people lost their homes. Some debt has been canceled. But most of it's still there. I just want to point out one thing. The light yellow says private finance. That grew from virtually nothing to 125% of GDP. Yeah, what is this? This is financial institutions owing other financial institutions. You can think of this as layering debt on debt on debt. And so that is really what we're talking about. We're talking about the financialization of the economy. Finance serving itself, as I said on one of the first slides. Going into debt to other financial institutions to buy financial. The other thing is households and nonprofit. This is just because of where data is kept. You can see that that is growing on trend and it grows faster before the crash. All right, our cycles now have more to do with consumption than they do with investment. And that doesn't seem to fit the investment theory of cycle, financial theory of investment that needs to be incorporated in this financial stability hypothesis. I won't go through this other stuff. But Minsky has said more generally in 1963 that a private sector-led expansion is inherently unstable. Government-led expansions, in other words, government increasing spending leading to an expansion, are much more sustainable. When the private sector leads, it gets heavily indebted. And the private sector eventually comes to a point where either it's too hard to make the payments or it decides it's too heavily indebted and will not borrow more. And then we get down. So it doesn't really have to be investment. It can be consumption too. And Minsky died in 1996, which is before this huge boom in consumer debt that we saw in the United States in the 2000s. Okay? But what I'm saying, it's not inconsistent with his views. And I actually did talk to him about this in 1982 because I wanted to speculate and see if you could see it in the data. Rising consumer debt that maybe was increasing the fragility of the economy. And for reasons I won't go into, it's very hard to get the kind of data I thought I needed to show this. And so I sort of put it on that back and it came back later. But in retrospect, we now know what happened. And again, even mainstream economists are starting to recognize this now. Mm-hmm. That since the early 1970s, we've had stagnant real wages in the US and a falling wage share, a rising profit share. Okay? This is in part due to low wage competition. In part, that is due to coming into the global capitalist economy, 2 billion new workers in China and India. Okay, that will make a difference to wage increase. And government policy, beginning with Ronald Reagan, busting the air traffic control. So, because wages haven't been going up, households have been using debt to cover the difference between what their wages could pay for and what they thought they aspired to in terms of a standard of living that is pushed on by television. And this has been accompanied by a rising share of profits in the financial sector because if you're going into debt, who are you paying? You're paying the banks. Okay. So we've had a rising share of profits in the financial sector. Here's just a quick picture showing the rise of financial profits. All right, this is not the picture. I'm not sure that it will be presented tomorrow. I don't have time to go through the whole thing in detail. But the idea is that at the level of the economy as a whole, it has to be true that spending equals income. Total spending in the United States equals total income in the United States. That has to be true. We can then divide our economy into a government sector and a private sector. Okay. And if one of those sectors runs a surplus, spends less than its income, the other sector must be spending more. Because spending has to equal income at the average level. Okay. Even if you don't follow that, you can see the picture. And the first thing you will see about the picture is that it's a mirror image around zero. Well, that has to be true. The surpluses have to equal the deficits. For every sector spending more than its income, that is running a deficit, below the zero, there has to be a sector spending less than its income running surplus above the zero. The second thing you notice is that the blue, which is the private sector, is virtually always above the line. The private sector, taken as a whole, this is households and firms taken together, are savers. Okay? And this is mostly because the household sector spends less than its income. It saves for college education for kids. The other thing you notice is there's a lot of red ink. The government sector virtually always runs a deficit. Okay, and before Ronald Reagan, you can see that those two are almost exactly a mirror image. The government's deficit equals the private sector surplus. Almost. Because you do see a little bit of green. The green is the third sector, that's the foreign sector. Okay. The U.S., before Reagan, was almost a closed economy. We could all, and our textbooks, if you ever took economics, never mentioned the foreign sector. Imports and exports really didn't matter in that sense. Okay. But after Reagan, they matter a lot. Because we start running current account deficits, in other words, we have trade deficits. That will show up above the line because it looks at it from the point of view of the rest of the world. The rest of the world runs a surplus against the United States. That's green. So that is what fills in the difference between the private sector and the economic sector. Okay. Fine thing. You can see that there's an exception to the rule. There is a blue. Two periods of blue below the line. This is where our private sector is spending more than it's income by a lot. Hadn't happened like this since the late 1920s. That was the last time the private sector had spent like this. So they're spending $1.06 for every dollar they have. Okay? And you see that that is occurring during the Clinton years. And then you see there's one exception to the rule that the government always runs deficits, and that is also the Clinton years. If you ignore the foreign sector just for a second, it has to be true by identity. That if Clinton is running budget surpluses, that means that our private sector is in deficit. Borrowing to spend, to allow the government to run surplus. Again, when's the last time the U.S. government ran a budget surplus? 1929. Budget surpluses drain income out of the economy and make those, which is exactly what we did. We went into a recession, but really unbelievably, the private sector decided to start spending like crazy again. This time, the housing. So they're borrowing against their houses to buy cars and furniture for the new houses. So anyway, we get the private sector deficit spending again, and then we crash into the global financial crisis. Private sector goes back to saving a lot, and the government goes back into a budget deficit. So we did have this period where it was a consumption-led boom. Where it was the consumer that was causing the instability. Policy response after the global financial crisis was very different from Roosevelt's response to the crash of finance capitalism. In many respects, money management capitalism is just a new version of finance capitalism. This time, the government decided to save on it rather than reform the system. And create a new kind of capitalism, one of the varieties of capitalism that would be a lot safer than the one we had. Instead, we saved it. The too big to fail institutions now are bigger than they were. Okay? They are more concentrated than they were. There are fewer of them. After the savings and loan crisis, we jailed 1,000. This time we jailed 0. And didn't even go after them. Because the Obama administration has a policy that maybe the banks commit crimes, but the people running the banks don't. I guess the banks really are people. not prosecuting them. And basically, they're relying on Wall Street to reform itself, and there's Dodd-Frank, which really continues in the vein of which is just get the incentives right, make the banks put in a little bit more of their own skin into these games, and then they wouldn't do risky things. Crazy. Okay? The banks had their skin in. And they couldn't pass it up. They thought this is such a great deal that we've got, we have to take a position in it. So anyway, what do we need? All right, what do we need to do? We need a new paradigm. So the textbooks in the old days, you get to about chapter 7 know, the macro textbook before they used the word government. Okay. Now they don't do it at all because the macro books are all based on a single representative agent who's maximizing utility through time. There is no. So instead, what we need to do is introduce the government on page one. The government is by far the largest economic entity in the economy, by far. The United States government is the biggest purchaser in the world, by far. And furthermore, the monetary system is the government's monetary system, almost without exception, around the world today, and as far back as you go in time, back to Babylonia, the monetary system has always been used by the authorities, created by the authorities, and used by the authorities. What do they use it for? To create and mobilize resources. You hope in the public. And occasionally, it probably is. Second, you have to discipline your analysis with balance sheets. When I was Minsky's student, come in and talk to him. You know, he'd listen to me for a couple minutes and say, go back home and discipline it with balance sheets. If you can't write out the balance sheet, you do not know what you're talking about. Virtually no economist can write a balance sheet for anything, and they definitely can't do it for the models that they're presenting, because there aren't any balance sheets there. So you start out financial assets, equal financial liabilities. As soon as you do that, think about the debt clock that used to be a time square, and you move it up the square. Okay, what is that? It's an asset clock. It's telling you how many assets the government is creating. Debts have to equal assets. You need stock open system modeling, I won't go into that. The macro sector balances, which is in the picture that I showed before. So you can't say stupid things like the Wall Street Journal said in 1999. They said, isn't it great that the government is running a surplus and adding the national saving? Left-hand column. A whole story. And the picture. Okay? And then on the right-hand side, a whole story about, isn't it terrible that the private sector isn't saving? Okay. The two are an identity. Right? This is the Wall Street Journal. Okay, so they don't understand separate analysis. Okay, second, we want to start with modern money views. So I suppose this will be presented tomorrow. I'll be very quick. Money is not primarily a medium of exchange. This is the way it's always introduced in economics textbooks. It's not primarily a means of circulation. Money is a state of knowledge. It's a unit of dollar is our money of account. Banks make payments to customers in bank IOUs denominated in the state's money account in the United States. Contingent monetary claims are orders of magnitude bigger than capital, bigger than safe and liquid assets, bigger than income, and bigger than production. Probably 99% of the financial sector has nothing to do with producing stuff and selling the stuff. A revised view of fiscal policy. We have a sovereign issuer of currency. Sovereign issuer spends by crediting bank accounts and taxes by debit. They cannot run out. It's literally impossible for the government to run out. Sovereign government cannot borrow its own currency. It's also literally impossible for the U.S. government to borrow dollars. It might be able to borrow euros, but it can't borrow dollars. Bond sales are just part of monetary policy. The sovereign supplies net financial savings. This is what I was getting to, the so-called debt clock. That is really a clock showing the net financial saving that the government has created for us. Fiscal policy dominates. It is exactly the opposite of what mainstream believes. They think that the Fed is controlling the economy. When actually the Fed is more like the Wizard of Oz, the steering wheel is not connected to anything. They think they're doing a lot, but they actually have virtually no influence whatsoever over the economy. And if we abandon the use of fiscal policy, we're abandoning any kind of control over the economy. A revised view of monetary policy. All that the central bank really does is sets the interest rate target, and then they supply reserves. They can't control the price. Furthermore, when the Fed decides to raise or lower the interest rate, we don't even know what direction the impact it will have. So the Fed raises the interest rate thinking it's stepping on the brake, that's what one of those words says, but actually it's stepping on the gas. And when the Fed is lowering the interest rate, as it did under QE, quantitative easing, it thinks that it's stepping on the gas when actually it's stepping on the brake. QE, for anyone who understood monetary policy, you knew it was going to have no effect on the economy, no positive effect on the economy, maybe a slight negative. So they don't even know what they're doing when they set their rates. They understand they set their rates, but they don't know what they're doing. Central bank policy is never independent. There's great belief that our Fed is independent, and thank goodness that they are. They are not. A revised view of finance. So the conventional view is based on this loan of funds approach. And that what financial markets do is they take in the savings and then they lend it out. Okay? The reality is that savings don't finance nothing. We have to reverse this. It is spending that creates the income, some of which can be saved. The spending has to come first. Okay? How is the spending financed? Well, the finance is created simultaneously with the spending, because what we have is a system of credits and debits. You can think of what banks do is they keep records for us. Okay? They keep records of the credits and debits. The spending is financed by a credit to somebody's bank account. Now, the main justification for freeing the financial system, okay, which we've been doing really even since the 1960s, it accelerated a bit in the 70s, and then full bore deregulation from the 80s through Clinton. The argument always was, we need more finance. We need to free them so that they can supply more finance. What we freed them to do was to financialize the economy, not to provide finance to productive activities. Financialization is not finance, it's leveraging and layering of debt on debt. So all of these things that we have now were not about increasing finance of productive activities. Building and owning homes. As Warren Moser points out, with those old Jimmy Stewart thrifts, we built and sold and financed more homes in 1974 than we did in the 2000s with the securitization. All of these things. I include Obamacare as financialization of the healthcare system. Continued financialization. In any case, finance is not a scarce resource. All it is keystrokes. As long as you have somebody with a finger that can keystroke, you can create finance. Okay. Finance is not scarce. Good borrowers are scarce. Good borrowers are the kind that can pay back. Right? Those are hard to find. Finance is infinite. Good borrowers are very finite. And what banks used to do is try to find the good borrowers. They don't do that anymore. Why? Because they don't hold the loans in. They package them together and sell them to dupes. That's the whole idea. Your pension fund is a good example of the dope that they're trying to sell us. Okay. Minsky always said he had a Wall Street view. That didn't mean he was pro-Wall Street. It just meant that he looked at it from the point of view of what Wall Street does. The vast majority of monetary transactions have little to do with circulating or producing. And so the typical models that economists start with, okay, in which the financial system and money are all about financing transactions in goods and services, is just false. It's going to take you to the wrong place. Much of the finance that's being created is to finance positions and assets. spending some money now, hoping to get more money later. Or exchanging the characteristics of income and outgo streams. So this is where we get all sorts of derivatives and swaps. And then many are hedges or bets on intake outcomes, so that's like default swaps, where you're betting somebody's going to die. And if they die, you get it. What do banks do? Banks are not money lenders. Minsky always said, if you want to find a money lender, you go to a street corner in Chicago, and the guy has a trench coat, and he's got dollar bills in his pockets. And you borrow from him. That's a money lender. You don't pay him back. You break some bills. Banks aren't money lenders. They don't have any money there. They're not intermediaries between savers and investors. Instead, what do? They accept liabilities. And then they make payments for their customers using their own liabilities. Most of that time, that means they pay other banks, whoever it is that you're paying. Or they make payments to the government using the government's own IOUs. These are facilitated by some banks. So think of banks as making payments rather than accepting savings. We also have to look at banks as being public-private partners. There's no such thing as a private bank. It cannot exist. They have to be public-private partners. Two reasons. One, we need par clearing. The U.S. tried banking without par clearing, which means that when you got a bank note from Bank A, you never knew at what rate Bank B would accept it. Okay, so to have par clearing, we need a central bank. If the central bank is going to do par clearing, they have to lend reserves. They have to stand by, always lend reserves to the banks that are suffering clearing. The second reason why we can't have private banks is because banks are taking positions and assets, and there's some risk involved in that. We can't let depositors lose their deposits because it causes bank runs. And so to stop bank runs, we also created deposit insurance. If you have the central bank acting as a lender of last resort, and the treasury acting as an insurer of deposits, there's no such thing as a private bank. The government's backstop. If the government's going to backstop them, markets will not work to discipline them. Even if they could in a very imaginary world, they will not be if the government's backstopping them. So the other side of the coin of the government backstop is the government must regulate them, which is what the government has not been doing very well for quite a while. Furthermore, if you want to try to get the banks to make good loans, that is, find those few good borrowers, you have to make them hold the loans to maturity. Otherwise, they have no incentive to do good underwriting. So what we need to do is try to return to relationship banking and moving away from markets to supply finance. Again, finance is not a scarce resource. All the arguments about why we need to free the banks doesn't hold up unless it is a scarce resource. And that says some good things about this idea of scarcity. Okay, to conclude, what do we need? We need to reform the financial system to promote capital development. And Minsky identified five basic elements that need to be provided by your financial system. The first is you need a safe and sound payment system. Safe and sound payment system. This is what we had after adopting deposit insurance and creating the Fed in 1913. We had a safe and sound payment system. And note that even though we just went through the worst financial crisis since the Great Depression, there were no runs on U.S. banks. Why is that? The government safety net. Okay? No one had any cause to run on American bank. You know, they did have a run on Northern Rock in the U.K. Why? Because the U.K. offered only 90% insurance of your deposits. Is any rational person going to leave deposits in a bank if they're only 90% covered? Of course not. You run. So in the United States, we effectively had 100% insurance for smaller deposits. And then when necessary, you raise the limit. So the state and sound payment system. Now, I say at the bottom, there's no reason why all these things need to be consolidated, no reason why they need to be provided by the private banks. An alternative to using the commercial banks and the thrifts to provide a safe and sound payment system is to use postal savings banks, which we had in the United States and which some countries still use. A postal savings bank is a government-run safe and sound payment system. And we might think about, well, if banks really don't want to supply the payment system, let's go back to a postal savings bank. So that could be a good alternative. Second, short-term loans to households and firms and possibly to state and local government. This is, again, what commercial banks used to do. And we can think of some kinds of loans, like student loans. Student loans, maybe it makes more sense to provide these directly through government loans rather than using the private banks to provide that kind of loan. Just in general, the way that you evaluate whether it should be the government doing it or a somewhat private bank doing it is to ask the question, how important is the underwriting? How complicated is underwriting? If underwriting is extremely important and it's difficult to do, perhaps the private banks can do it better than the government can do it. On the other hand, if the underwriting isn't so important and if there is a big public purpose in promoting the activity, like going to college, the underwriting doesn't matter that much. So what if 10% of the students default? Maybe you want to do it through government loans. Housing, maybe housing also is a public good. Okay. And maybe we can tolerate a higher default rate. Then, again, the government ought to provide the loans directly. Safe and sound housing finance system. We had that. Jimmy Stewart thrifts. Safe and sound. Homeowners virtually never defaulted, and the thrifts never failed. Until we freed them in 1970. They said, you don't have to be Jimmy Stewart kind of thrifts anymore. You could be bought by real estate developers and eventually drug runners and CIA funded groups. And then, of course, they failed. Right, so we could go back. Or again, we might decide just to do it right. A range of financial services, including insurance, brokerage, retirement savings services, and so on. Typically, these were investment kinds of services. And finding long-term funding of positions in expensive capital assets. Again, this was investment kinds of services. However, there's no reason why all these things need to be consulted. I'll stop if we still have time. Glad to take questions.
Thank you. Yes, we do have a few minutes.
Yeah. complete exchange, which should indicate that it's quite unstable. What are the solutions? We've heard several ideas from the government to shoot the right amount of money to the apparel brands in the country.
But so many of my friends support transactions taxes. So Tobin tax, financial transactions tax, to slow things down. Okay, so if you have to pay, they claim very low percentages, so well below 1% transaction tax every time you sell an asset, then that will slow things down. This probably is true and probably would help a little bit. So we have computerized trading, which I think even pretty mainstream people are starting to recognize as being a problem. So that's sort of a conventional way to slow that down and make things a little more stable. I would, without saying we shouldn't do that, I would take a different approach. So, Eric Des Moines, who's written a lot on this and was one of our students, proposed that we should treat financial innovations just like drug innovations. Okay? Most of them are bad. Okay? Dangerous, deadly, kill the patients, and so they have to be approved before you use them. Okay, so it takes a very long process and expensive to get new drugs approved. And that probably is a good thing. Financial innovations, you don't have to get any approval at all. So you go ahead and start trying them and they turn out to be deadly and dangerous, and then maybe they'll be out. Maybe. Although virtually everything that was done to cause the global financial crisis is starting to be done again. Okay. So I think that this is a good idea. So, okay, fine, you guys innovate, but it has to be approved before you can do it. So I think that would at least put a bit of a barrier between the innovation and immediately starting to do it. I think it also would be nice if the government wasn't so ready to bail out the institutions that make mistakes. I think that all of the big banks should have been shut down and dissolved. And not only does that prevent them from continuing to cause problems, which they will do, troubled banks generally get more trouble when you intervene and help them. But also, it sends a message. Right? And we didn't do that at all. So I think that also just comes with sense. Oh, you are? Stretching. Oh, you
are. I just had a question following up with you. Just hanging out. Financial contracts are contracts. So what you're talking about is not just having a situation where no contracts are allowed until we approve a kind of contract, which seems to be very kind of counter to what I understand.
Yeah. Okay. So I should be more specific. So I'm talking about particular kinds of institutions. Okay? And so if you and he went to engage in some kind of crazy scheme, and you're both willing to put your names on it, I'm much less willing to say that we ought to intervene. So we have protected financial institutions, okay, commercial banks, and I'm talking about what we allow them to. Which I know that it's become very complicated because a huge part of the financial system is not in those categories. However, the big
Hi, Professor Wray. So I'm a lawyer, and my practice is mostly around small businesses and startup firms. And in Ohio, we have a pretty good infrastructure as far as trying to mentor entrepreneurs and these things with this Third Frontier program, and they have this innovation fund. But as it turns out, as you point out, a lot of this, they're not ready to fund these entrepreneurs. They tell these guys, you know, you've got a great idea, you've got a great product, software, but you don't really have a company. And so it comes down to, like you said, they even have a phrase for it, friends, family, and fools. The people who do get funding for their capital expenditures are basically, they're betting on an idea that they think is good. And so, but the fact is as you point out, a lot of these guys maybe aren't creditworthy borrowers because a lot of these startup firms will fail, but it may be a public good to have a lot of these companies start. They're buying properties, they're buying, making capital expenditures and this sort of thing. So what I'm wondering is, how could a state like Ohio, which wants to try to fund this innovation, create the type of loans for these sorts of endeavors?
Yeah, it's, in this project, Mariana and I always had a tension because this is exactly what she's interested in, promoting, and getting the state involved in this stuff, and also pressuring financial institutions to play a bigger role. And when I look at financial institutions like commercial banks, I say, but I'm always saying, I'm not sure I want commercial banks to get involved in this because it is too risky. So you can get the fools, but also the angels who are willing to put money in and win 2 times out of 100. And that's fine. Venture capitalists can become extremely rich in two cases out of 100. Commercial banks cannot live that way. They've got to make it 98 times out of 100. So I don't think we want our protected financial institutions to get involved in that. And we definitely need to create more alternatives to provide that very risky kind of funding in early stages. So I would just suggest you look more at Mariana's other work, because she's written a lot of this. Okay, what?
Luis, I was wondering if the 5 points that you highlighted in the last slide also applies for international financial. For example, the IMF or the World Bank. The IMF and the World Bank have been criticized in many periods,
responsible for what happened to many developing countries. Okay, first I thought you were talking about international banking. And so I was just going to quote Keynes. Nothing is more certain than that banking should be domestic, national. Okay. And I'm biased toward that view. There's arguments that, well, if you don't do such and such and such, U.S. banks are going to lose all that kind of business to London. I said, good. Let them have it. We shouldn't be pushing our banks to get involved in competing with the London banks. On the IMF and the World Bank, it's just not an area. Critical, but there's just not much that I can say. It seems to me that most of what they do is probably not very helpful at all. Poor developing countries do not need loans. They need aid. Okay? And so getting a highly indebted country into more debt is just crazy. And Greece now, of course, is exactly in that situation. They don't need loans. They need debt. So I just can't see anything.
I just saw 2 hands, and I think both of those were Sade and Paul. Sade. Just to follow Louis's question, what I'm interested in how, when we know the side of the financialization, and it's in back to national economy, but I believe so beyond the national economy. So let's just say in the US, how we could stop financialization from dictating public policy. How we can do that?
Well, again, part of the problem was that we let commercial banks create all sorts of subsidiaries that did things we didn't want commercial banks to do, okay? And, you know, this should just be illegal. They shouldn't be allowed to have anything off their balance sheet. Anything they do should be on their balance sheet. So that we can see it. And so that, you know, they're not in running around the capital requirements. I'm, like Minsky, I'm not a huge fan of just raising capital requirements. I don't think you're going to do much because you can actually make the banks more risky. But you definitely, once you've got them in place, you don't want banks to be able to get around them by putting stuff off their balance sheets. And they've been doing this for a long time. It wasn't something they invented in the 2000s. I wrote my dissertation in the mid-80s, and I have a whole section on balance sheet operations at commercial banks. So they have been getting away with it for a long time. And it's very clear why they were doing it, is to get around the rules and regulations. Okay, so this should be illegal. Everything should be on the balance sheet, out of the open, transparent. But that is one way, because a lot of people think we have the shadow banks and then we have the real banks. But the shadow banks are financed by the real banks, right? And without the real banks, they couldn't do what they have been doing. So they really needed that. So if we cut that link and say, no, we can't finance shadow banks, we wouldn't have half the problems we have with the shadow banks.
My question is really around you studied the history of human behavior, in essence, by seeing these crises, and it's an intersection of self-interest and group interest. Crises seem to be caused when self-interest overwhelms group interest. So one of the words that we could use to summarize all this is accountability, how to bring accountability, to both walk that tightrope of self-interest and group interest, how to bring the accountability of a penalty for your behavior. So like Volkswagen, you cannot sue a company in Germany, but you can sue people. So somebody would be going to jail for Volkswagen. So they did a bunch of jail in 2008. So what are your observations of how to bring accountability into the system, either from history or the other things?
Yeah. Well, I think you got it. You had to throw a lot of people in prison, a lot. The savings and loan crisis was small relative to this crisis, okay? And 1,000 in prison. So this time should have been a lot more than that. And we didn't go after anyone. So no one was held accountable. And
why
this
not? Why will we not go after the person?
Well, because this was the Obama administration's policy, set by Holder. This was Holder's policy. We will not go after it. Why? Because it will damage the reputation of these firms. He said this in public. Okay. It will damage the reputation of, say, Bank of America.
Good.
Which is a criminal enterprise. It is. It's admitted to fraud after fraud after fraud and still engaging. But we will not do anything that will damage their reputation, as if it could be damaged. So it's just
to follow up on that.
And I really do think they're waiting for the statute of limitations to run. Because now they are starting to go after.
So could citizens file a lawsuit against the government for being accessory to
the fraud? We have a lawyer type here.
Matt, and Rohan, do you have something to say very quickly, Matt?
just because, you know, fraud after fraud after fraud, but wouldn't you agree that fraud exacerbates the crisis, but eliminating fraud alone would not eliminate the crisis because, as you've explained, Minsky thought that the crisis was endogenous to capitalism, not because of bad people in those good working institutions.
Okay, so, you know, first, there's always some fraud, okay? But what happens in these bubbles is that you create conditions in which fraud really pays off and pays big. And so the incentives to do it get much bigger, and then you blow the thing up bigger, so the fall is much worse. So I agree with that. I think, so this is just speculation, because fraud occurred in all the ones,
right?
All the ones I listed, right? Massive frauds occurred. I think you can still get the boom and crash, even with no fraud. Okay, and that was definitely Minsky's position. Although our colleague Bill Black is skeptical. He puts a big weight on fraud. And it's clearly important. Clearly, if you leave it out of the story, you are missing a huge part of the story, these booms and busts. But I think that what happens is that, you know, for all Minsky reasons, you start getting the increased fragility, increased leverage ratios, and then the fraudsters see the profits that they can make, and they're encouraged. There has been deterioration in the various offices that are supposed to supervise. So the SEC, we've seen it there too. And then just a tremendous revolving door. So that it's not just that the public stewards see they're in to get a job on Wall Street, but you know they're running around with the same people, and these are their friends, and they trust them, and can't see them as criminals. So I think that this is a huge problem. When the Fed's transcripts were first released, I read those, and now I've read some surrounding the crisis period. And, you know, on the one hand, there's no conspiracy, obviously, right? But there definitely is concern for the institutions and the individuals in those institutions, and trust in those people, right? And so I think that there is this culture, and that is a big problem. So the people are supposed to be regulating, do not see them as adversaries. I and they should. They shouldn't trust them at all. On the second part, I think the Basel agreements are, they've gone in the wrong direction. And so, trying to use agreements that are coming out of this group to regulate a domestic system is a huge problem. All of the, I wrote on the Basel II 10 years ago, whatever it was, and it was very clear what they were setting up, a system of self-regulation and great trust in the credit rating agencies. Know where that went. So I'm pretty skeptical of that group on the necessity